It would be impossible for me to overstate the significance and the enormity and the magnitude of what happened 2,000 years ago on Resurrection Sunday. It would be impossible for me to overstate how massively important and significant the resurrection of Jesus Christ is. And as much as skeptics have their hearts set on dismissing it, historical evidence is very good and very strong for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have the empty tomb, for example. Has it ever occurred to you that it's kind of odd that for 2,000 years no one has ever been able to come up with the body of Jesus Christ? Because it's not here. He is alive. The credibility of the eyewitness accounts. All serious historians would say that these eyewitness accounts and records of these eyewitness accounts are reliable, are verifiable historically. Put aside the Bible for a second. They're reliable. How about the global revolution called Christianity that spread from one small place called Jerusalem that reached the far-reaching parts of the world through a group of 11 or 12 insignificant people? No one should listen to them. And at the center of their message was the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They weren't trying to make people feel good. They weren't trying to put on presentations, trying to draw in the masses for what? They were preaching a message that would cost them their lives. How does this message advance like this? How does this message go from one place in Jerusalem around the world with such force and power in the face of opposition and persecution? How does that happen? It happens because God is advancing this message of the gospel of the resurrection. It happens because the resurrection of Jesus Christ is true. It's reliable. It's verifiable. And the reason the gospel is advancing all over the world is because God is behind it. It's not a message that belongs to human beings. It's a message that comes from God, who is entrusted to us. The message that Jesus Christ lived a perfect life. He died on the cross for our sins, and he rose from the grave 3 days later. It's a message that's changing people's lives. How about that? How about hundreds of thousands of millions of people that are putting their faith in Jesus Christ? Not because it feels good for them. In many cases, it's costing them their own lives. Why is this happening in such a wide-scale way? Because the message is true. Because the resurrection of Jesus Christ happened. Because Jesus Christ is not dead. He wasn't just a good man. He was 100% God and 100% man at the same time. And he chose to lay down his life to save sinners like you and me. And he chose to take his life back up again with great power and authority. So the purpose of this message today is not to rehearse the historicity of the resurrection. We can do that. But I want to take you to a passage of scripture that records for us the biblical, and it is a historical account of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So if you have your Bible, go with me to Matthew chapter 28. And we're going to read verses 1 to 10. Matthew 28, verses 1 to 10. If you don't have a Bible, you can slip up your hands, and one of the ushers on either side would love to get a copy of God's Word into your hands. And if you don't own a Bible, that Bible will be our gift to you. We'd love you to take it home and read it and have your life changed by these words, which we know are the Word of God. Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 to 10. This is Matthew's account of the resurrection. It says this: "Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know you seek Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen as he said. Come see the place where he lay. Then go quickly to tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you.' So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." As I said for you, this is the passage of Scripture that is Matthew's account of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and it's a reliable account. I want to remind you, it's not a fictional story, it's not a fable, it's not a fairy tale. This is true and this is reliable. And I want to show you some things from this portion of Scripture that I believe will illuminate our hearts, that will change our lives. And maybe you're in this room today and you need a change in direction. Maybe you're in this room today, you don't know you need a change in direction. Well, God's Word will speak to us very powerfully, I believe. So write this down. This is where we're going to start. The resurrection of Jesus Christ confronts the world, confronts all of humanity, confronts you and I today. The resurrection of Jesus Christ confronts the world's low expectations of life. The resurrection of Jesus Christ confronts the world and our low expectations of life. Let me show you what I mean by that. Notice verse 1. It says, "Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb." Mary Magdalene and the other Mary loved Jesus so much. They were with him throughout his earthly ministry and until his final breath on the cross. There were other women there. We know that from Mark's account, but Matthew decides to focus particularly on the two Marys. We have to understand what they would have been feeling as they approached the tomb that day. We have to begin to live in the text and begin to understand and feel what they felt. They would have been feeling an intense sense of grief. This Jesus, their master, whom they loved and whom they followed for the past 3 years, is now, in their minds, he is dead, and they're grieving. There would have been intense mourning. There would have been psychological and emotional trauma. Just remember what they experienced just a couple days before. They experienced the one whom they loved, the Savior Jesus Christ. They experienced him brutally beaten and flogged and humiliated and mocked. This man that they loved so much. A traumatizing event for them, no doubt. And they were experiencing the deep pain of loss. They felt the loss of their Savior. And if you've ever lost someone you love, you understand what that feels like. You understand the grieving and the emotional struggle that you're feeling. We also have to understand that they were coming to the tomb, listen, with very, very low expectations of Jesus Christ. They're coming to the tomb expecting Jesus' dead body. They're coming to the tomb, listen, in spite of the fact that Jesus has predicted that he will be raised from the dead on this very day, as they walk towards the tomb, they're coming to the tomb with very low expectations because they're expecting him to be dead. Now, you got to understand what's going on here. This is the Jesus that healed the sick and raised the dead and fed thousands and thousands of people with very limited physical resources. This is the Jesus that made blind eyes see. They saw him do miraculous things. This is the Jesus they knew would walk on water. This miraculous Jesus. The Jesus that predicted that he would be raised from the dead, yet they have such low expectations. They approach the tomb expecting a dead Jesus. And we know that because Mark's account tells us that they come with spices ready to anoint his body. The only thing they're expecting to see is a dead body. While they're coming with compassion, they're coming with love, they're coming out of devotion, we have to see that they're coming with very, very low expectations. Now on the screen for you is a picture of Steve Jobs. Many of you may have heard of him. Steve Jobs was the creative mind behind the worldwide tech company named Apple. At the pinnacle of his career, Steve Jobs was diagnosed with cancer. Listen to what one colleague said about him. He said, "There is not a single executive or creator in the technological industry more important than Steve Jobs." Born in San Francisco, California, on February 24, 1955, he was adopted by Paul and Clara Jobs shortly after his birth. In 1976, Steve Jobs started Apple Computers from his garage, and with the Apple II, they found success. Within 2 years, they were selling over $100 million worth of computers. Another colleague of his said this: "The iPhone is the single most important device of the modern era. The iPod to the iPhone to the iPad has been the most important trend in technology. What Apple has done is raise the world's awareness of design and functionality. People look at these things and they just have to have them." In 2011, Forbes magazine named Apple the most valuable company in the world. That same year, Steve Jobs resigned as CEO. And on October 5th of 2011, Steve Jobs died of pancreatic cancer. Every year of his life, Steve Jobs would read the same book and be inspired by this book. And within this book, there was contained the following quote: "You must not let your life run in the ordinary way. Do something that nobody else has done, something that will dazzle the world." This is one of the quotes found in a book that really fueled Steve Jobs and all his success and fueled his creativity and inspired him so many times. And while this quote may be inspiring, I want you to see something here. It is spectacularly insufficient for life. It sets us up with a spectacularly low bar of what we can know and experience in this life. Sure, don't let your life run in the ordinary. Sure, do something that nobody else has done. That's great, do that. Sure, do something that will dazzle the world. Then what? Then what? Steve Jobs passed away. What we have to understand is that even our greatest and highest expectations and achievements in this life fall way short of the glory of what God intends for us if we miss the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If we miss the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we can have the loftiest educational goals and expectations. We can have the greatest career goals and expectations. We can have the highest family goals and expectations. We can have the most ambitious financial goals and expectations. None of these are bad in and of themselves, but if we miss the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we set ourselves up with a very, very low bar, a very, very low set of expectations compared to what God has for us, what God wants for us through an understanding and an awareness of the power of the resurrection. If we fail to see that Jesus Christ came to earth and died to pay the penalty of our sins, if we fail to see that Jesus Christ again then rose from the grave, defeating death so that he can give us eternal life, we will continue to live life with a very, very low set of expectations. And this, loved ones, is the tragedy of millions and millions of lives all around the world. The two Marys come to the tomb with a set of very low expectations of Jesus Christ. They're expecting him to be dead. And so many in this room live life, so many around the world live life with a set of very, very low expectations of what can be known and experienced in this life and beyond. So many of us in this room, we live as if Jesus is dead. We live as if there's no Jesus. He's dead. He's buried somewhere. And so we pursue other things. We worship other things. We elevate other things. We set high expectations of other things to meet our needs and satisfy the deepest longings of our heart. We live like Jesus is dead. But he's not dead. He is alive. And he summons us. He calls us. He beckons us to understand what life really is. What true life really is, where true life is really found, it's found only in an understanding of his death and resurrection. Don't live your life as if Jesus Christ is dead, seeking fulfillment and joy and freedom in other things. He is the remedy for the restlessness of the human heart, and some in this room may be experiencing a type of restlessness where you've tried so many things and nothing seems to satisfy your heart. You've set the best career goals for yourself. You've even met them. You're doing really well. But you still have this restlessness in your heart. Why is that so? Why? Why do celebrities who have seemingly achieved everything that they ever dreamed of achieving, why do they go on to commit suicide so often? Why do they do that? It's because the things of this world are empty. It's because nothing in this world can ever satisfy the deepest longings of our hearts. It's because thousands and thousands of people all over the world live their lives with such a low bar of expectation. And maybe a new house will satisfy me. Maybe a new car will make me feel better. Maybe our relationship, maybe when I get married. Maybe when I have children, maybe when my children grow up and they succeed. Maybe that renovation, maybe that job. Such a low bar. Such a low bar. Low expectations compared to what we would find in and through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The resurrection of Jesus Christ confronts you and me today. Confronts our low expectations of what we can know and experience in this life and beyond. Second thing I want to show you is this. The resurrection of Jesus Christ confronts the world's lack of hope in life. Not only the low expectations we have of life, but the resurrection confronts our lack of hope in life. Notice verse 2 to 6. It says, "And behold, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, to the women, excuse me, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen as he said. Come see the place where he lay.'" So you got to understand, we have the two Marys and the other women that would have been with them. They receive an earth-shattering, literally an earth-shattering surprise. Remember, as they approach the tomb, they do so with the expectation that Jesus is dead, and therefore with hearts that are filled with a sense of hopelessness. Because there's nothing more final than death. And they're not going there hoping that he'll get better. They're going there with a sense that this is final, he's dead. We also have to remember that the death of Jesus Christ put an end to all their messianic hopes and expectations. You have to remember that the people that were following Jesus had these hopes that Jesus was the Messiah, which he was, but they had a different idea of what the Messiah had come to do. They thought he had come to set up an earthly kingdom, so they had high hopes. Jesus, are you going to set up this kingdom now? They had high hopes that Jesus would put off and put away the Roman oppression that was upon them, and finally, once and for all, do away with all of what the Romans were doing to the people of Israel. They had high hopes that they would be with Jesus in this kingdom, that he would establish it. You have to understand something here. With the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, all of their hopes and dreams and messianic expectations came crashing down. And so they come to the tomb, and they come with low expectations, expecting to find Jesus dead there. But they come, and they don't have much hope. They come with a sense of hopelessness. They come with a sense of despair. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever felt a sense of hopelessness in your life? Have you ever felt like you're just crushed by the weight of circumstances around you that you can't seem to find your way through? Maybe there's someone in the room, or two people, or 10 people in the room, and you're in the middle of a season like that right now, where you literally look around at your life and you're like, "I don't know what to do. I feel hopeless." Well, that's what the two Marys experienced. That's what the women that were with Jesus that come to the tomb, that's what they're feeling. That's what they're experiencing in this moment. And the Word of God brings us some very clear instruction to them, and some very clear hope for them, and I believe hope for us today as well. So write this down. When all hope seems lost, I must believe, if you feel hopeless today, you must believe this, that God is bigger than all my circumstances. When hope seems lost, when all hope seems lost, I must believe that God is bigger than all my circumstances. Notice verse 2 and 3, it says, "And behold, there was a great earthquake, and an angel of the Lord descended from heaven, and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow." Notice now the supernatural earthquake. Something supernatural is happening here. Notice the supernatural presence of the angel from heaven. Notice the appearance of the angel is like lightning, and his clothes white as snow. We can't miss what's happening here in this moment. The one who is shaking the earth and commanding the worship of innumerable angels is the one who comes to the two Marys in their despair and in their hopelessness with the hope of a resurrected Savior. The hope of a resurrected Savior which will surpass all their prior expectations of what Jesus could do or would do. He is raised from the dead, and that's the hope that they have in Him. Because listen, love, when some of us are feeling hopeless right now, you have to understand that your hope can only be found in the embrace of a Savior, Jesus Christ, who not only died to pay the penalty for my sin, but was raised to new life, to give me new life. That's the hope that the angel is bringing to the two Marys. What you're going through here, God, what you think is so rough right now, there's hope coming your way. Jesus is not dead, He's alive. That's the word He brings to us. So I want you to write this down now. When all hope seems lost, I must believe that God is bigger than my circumstances. Here's the hope now. When all hope seems lost, I must believe that through the resurrection, I have nothing to fear. I must believe that through the resurrection, I have nothing to fear. Notice now verses 4 to 6. It says, "And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen as he said. Come see the place where he lay.'" So the guards that were guarding the tomb, and this was a big deal, that they protect the tomb, and now all of a sudden the stone is rolled away. They fall down out of terror and fear, and then the Bible says it's like they're dead, finished laying there, dead. But then the angel says to the women, "Do not be afraid." And this might be for someone here in this room today, in the midst of your hopelessness. God's word says, "Do not be afraid. I know you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen as he said." Essentially, the angel is saying to the women, don't be afraid. You've come here with terribly low expectations. You've come here expecting to find a dead body. You've come here not knowing the fullness of what God has for you, the fullness of how God will meet you in the middle of your hopelessness. And he comes and says, you will never need to fear again because of what I'm about to tell you, what I'm about to show you. Jesus Christ is alive, and we have nothing to fear. On the screen for you is a picture of a young man that I read about this week, a 17-year-old student of Central Tech here in Toronto, Central Tech High School in downtown Toronto. On March 25th, his name is Ravonte Ball. He collapsed on the basketball court in the middle of a game. One of his teammates said as he started making noises, we said, "Whoa, give him some space." He was shaking, so we put him on his side, and he started foaming out of the mouth. We were panicking. We didn't know what to do. Ravonte was admitted to Sick Kids Hospital, where he's been in a coma ever since. It's a very, very sad situation. His mother said, "I just keep praying and hoping that he'll wake up, that someday I'll see his smile again." When he fell, she says, it took paramedics around 20 minutes to find his pulse. Vital minutes as his brain was being deprived of oxygen. "I don't know what the future looks like for my son right now. I've been told he might never walk. He might never talk. His major functions are gone." His friends and family call this a wake-up call. And it is a wake-up call. It's a wake-up call because it reminds us that life is fragile. It reminds us, the Bible says, that life is like a mist. Here you go. Here's this guy, a great basketball player in high school. He's playing. He's in good shape. He's running up and down the court. He just collapses. No one understands why. Doctors are working on it. It's a wake-up call because it shows us that life is short. And what we need to consider today is what we are doing in this life and what we have placed our hope in this life. Because the reality of life is that bad things happen all the time. Maybe you're in a situation where something bad has happened to you, or you're in the middle of something very difficult. You've lived long enough, you understand. Bad things happen all the time. The reason the resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us so much hope and dispels all of our fears is because for all who believe, we are promised a resurrection of our own. This life is not all there is to live for. If we're putting all our hope in in this life, if we're putting all our eggs in this basket, we will be tremendously disappointed and we will come up short over and over and over again. What we need to understand is we live this life with this truth that there is an afterlife. And if you're given 80 or 90 years on this planet, you've lived a long, full life, and then we walk into eternity. And so the angel confronts the two Marys here with their hopelessness, and he gives them news that shows them that they will never have to fear anything again, because no matter what happens to them in this life, Jesus' resurrection guarantees for them and for us and for all who would believe a resurrection of our own. That means you could be going through the hardest thing in your life. You could be facing the hard, your whole life can be so challenging and difficult, but this is not all there is. And if we're putting our hope in this life, we are setting ourselves up with such massively low expectations compared to what God has for us. The reason, as I said, the resurrection gives us so much hope is because it dispels all of our fear, because we understand where true hope is found. It's not here. It's not that I live a perfect life and it goes so well and everything's going well for me. That's not what it is. We never promised a perfect life here on earth. In fact, I'm looking at a bunch of people in this room today. You've walked through some hard things in your life for sure. All of us have. Listen to what Jesus said in Matthew 10:28 on the screen for you. He said, "Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell." Paraphrase, what Jesus is saying to his disciples is, no matter what happens to you here in this life, you have nothing to fear if you place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, because there is a place that I'm preparing for you that you will go if you trust me. You will die one day, all of us will. You will die physically, but you don't have to die spiritually. Because once we pass from this life, we walk and we'll stand before Jesus Christ. And the question that is confronting us today is, what are we putting our hope in? Have we put our hope in that day that we stand before Jesus Christ and have our sin debt canceled and our eternity secure? Or are we walking around this life trying so much to achieve hope here and satisfaction here? The two Marys, they didn't need to fear the angel. They didn't need to fear what had transpired, because Jesus Christ was now alive. Their eternal destinies had been secured. And when it all comes down to it, where you spend eternity is really the only thing that matters. It's the only thing that matters, where you're going to spend eternity. Because regardless of whether you live an easy life or a difficult life, a wealthy life or a poor life, a life in prosperous Canada or a life in war-torn Syria, the only thing that matters is whether you've received the hope of eternal life. That's all that matters. And so today the Word of God is confronting us with our lack of hope in life. Some of us in this room, we're chasing things. We're hoping it satisfies our hearts. We're chasing things, we're pursuing things, we're hoping it blesses our hearts and fills us with joy. But you know, when you chase the things of this world, we always come up short, we always come up empty. It will always be that way. That's what God's Word shows us. There is a better way for your life. There is a better hope for your life. It is the hope that is found in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That you can live this life, and here and now you can put your faith in Jesus and say, "I want to follow you, and I can have hope for the next life." Because this life, no matter if you have 80 or 90 years or whatnot, it's short. It's short compared to eternity. I'm not guaranteed another hour, neither are you. We're not guaranteed. We don't know what's going to happen. That young man who collapsed on the basketball court, he didn't expect that to happen that day. Have you settled things in your heart with Jesus Christ? Have you embraced the truth of the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Are you putting it to the side? Are you ignoring it? Are you refusing to believe it? Are you still on that hot pursuit? Oh, if I just get married, that's going to satisfy my life. Oh, if I just raise my kids to be really successful, that's going to satisfy my life. Oh, if I just climb the corporate ladder and get up here, that's going to make me really happy. All waste of time, man. If it's your hope. If it's your hope. Resurrection of Jesus Christ is hope. It's hope for eternal life. It's hope for a life that will never end with Him in glory. So some of you say, "Well, I want to do that. Let me do that. What do I need to do?" here's a short answer. You can't do anything to get eternal life. It's a gift that you can receive. It's a gift that you can receive today. Let me show you the path to a life of hope and eternal life on the screen for you. The path to true hope. What do you need to do? Well, this is what you should do. First, it starts with admitting, I know that I'm a sinner. You got to admit that you're a sinner. You need a Savior. What Jesus did on the cross wasn't a waste of time. When Jesus died on the cross, he was bearing the weight of the sins of the world upon himself. That's yours and mine. Wasn't a waste of time. It wasn't a futile death. He died on the cross and he says, all of your sin I put upon myself. If you would admit that you're a sinner and receive forgiveness. That's the second thing. You got to admit, know that we're sinners. Second thing is you got to repent. Please forgive me. Jesus, please forgive me. I turn away from my sin. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You say, Jason, you don't know what I've done. I've done some bad things. Jesus can't accept me. God can't. I've been in church before and he's made me feel really guilty. You know, and I don't want that. And I'm just telling you, no matter what you've done, do you know that it can be covered by the blood of Jesus that was on the cross? No matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, Jesus Christ died to pay for the penalty of your sin. You've got to admit that we're sinners. You've got to repent. Please forgive me and turn away from my sin. He will forgive you. And then we've got to trust. We've got to trust. I believe that only Jesus can save me. This is important because, you know, in our city and in our country, there's a lot of talk of tolerance, and there's a lot of people that will say to you, well, if Jesus is good for you, that's good. You can go ahead and put your trust in him, but I want to be spiritual in this way. Or I'm going to put my faith in this other thing. Or I'm going to not. Here's what the Bible tells us. Jesus Christ is the only way to be saved. And so we need to admit that we're sinners. We need to repent and turn from our sin. And we need to trust in Jesus Christ. He alone is the way to eternal life. You say, but I do good things. But there's no amount of good things you can do to get you to heaven. You say, no, you don't understand. Like, I'm really a good guy. No one is good. Did you know that? The Bible tells us there's no one righteous, not even one. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You say, I'm not that bad. I said, compared to what? Compared to the person next to you, maybe you're not that bad. But compared to God's holy standards, you're so bad. Here's what we have to see. And so we're all sinners. We need to repent. Lord, please forgive me. He will. He will. He will. He's willing. He's not reluctant. He will. And we need to trust and believe. Only Jesus can save me. John 14:6, Jesus said to them, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Ephesians 2:8 and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith. Faith. And this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God. That result works so that no one may boast. Maybe you're here in this room, you're trying to work yourself to God. You're trying to get yourself there. A lot of people that fill churches all the time, they think that they're getting themselves to God. You serve the church, you give a lot of money to the church, you're doing my thing, I'm just, you know, God's really happy with me. You can't work your way to God. You have to come to the end of yourself. You have to say, man, not as good as I thought it was. I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. Jesus to come and save me and wash away my sin. Lord, please forgive me. Forgive me. And he will. He'll cleanse you. Turn away from your sin and trust in Jesus Christ. He and he alone will give us, give you the hope that you so desperately seek. Especially if you're in this room today and you're feeling a sense of hopelessness and despair. You say, Jason, you don't understand. My situation is really hopeless. I can't find hope in this life until my situation changes. I tell you, you're wrong. Hope is found in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why there's people around the world that are literally dying for Jesus today, that their last dying words are a song of praise and joy to him as their heads kick off. How do they do that? It's because they know the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and they're not so worried. Oh, no, I'm not going to live another day. They're like, take me home, Jesus. I'm coming. Nothing to fear. Hope is not in this life. Hope is beyond. If you were to die today, do you know where you're going tomorrow? Do you know? I'm talking with a lot of people who attend church all their life, and I ask them this question, do you know where you're going to die tomorrow? And they say, I'm not really sure. And I go to church. Going to church doesn't save you. Doing good things doesn't save you. Are you saved today? How do you know? I admitted that. sin in repentance. And if you put your trust in Jesus Christ such that you say, I'm not going to pursue anything else in this life that I think is going to satisfy me and be the deepest longings of my heart. I'm going to know that the deepest longings of my heart are met and satisfied by Jesus Christ in relationship with Him. Notice verse 7 to 10. Then go quickly, the angel says, and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you. So they departed quickly from the tomb, and with fear and great joy they ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, greetings. Imagine that moment. And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. And there they will see me. Notice that Jesus was waiting for them in verse 7. Listen, Jesus is waiting for you. He's waiting for you. Notice that they went quickly with fear, reverent fear, and great joy. In verse 8, do you need joy today? Do you need joy? Listen, life is hard. Life is hard. Where can you find joy? You can find joy in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You may die in this life. Absolutely, every single one of us will. You don't have to die in the next life. That's joy. That's joy. I know where I'm going to go when I die. When I leave this earth, I'm going to be with Him forever. That's joy. That's joy. Notice that Jesus greets them in verse 9. Imagine that moment for a second. The Bible tells us that they fall down, taking hold of His feet that had been nailed to the cross. The Bible says they worshipped Him. Imagine that moment. Falling down and holding the feet of Jesus Christ. Now, He has a glorified body, a perfect body, but in His body He will bear for all eternity the marks of His crucifixion, because it will be a constant, eternal reminder of what He did for us on the cross, and all the worship of heaven will worship Him and will be fueled by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Lamb that was slain. So there they are, feeling, holding His feet, and they feel the holes in His feet, and they're holding, and they worship Him. That's awesome. Notice now verse 10, Jesus said to them, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, because your sins have been forgiven. Your sins have been paid for. Death has been defeated. New life is now offered to the world through me. Nothing in this life will ever shake you because of the glory that awaits you in heaven. And they worship. Worship Jesus Christ. Do you worship Jesus? Do you worship Jesus? I'm telling you, I get sick and tired of my own heart so often, running after so many stupid things that are satisfied the deepest longings of my heart. Just tell me. I talk with enough people in our church and beyond to know this is a problem of humanity. We worship other things. We run after other things. We need to snap out of it. We need to see the resurrection of Jesus Christ is where hope is found. And to pin our hopes on Him, put our trust in Him, and to allow Him to live within us, unite our hearts to Him, and to save us. Right now, love us. Right now. Right now, God can save you. I don't know you. I don't know where you're from. Or I don't know. I see a lot of familiar faces from our church. I love you all. There's other people I don't really recognize. Are you saved? If you died today, are you saved? Tell me, everyone here. You know you're a sinner needing a Savior, forgiveness. Put your faith in Jesus Christ. You can do that right now.